Good afternoon. Let's hear a little, come on, a little bit more response. Good afternoon. So welcome to the third annual Digital Learning Day brought to you from the prestigious and beautiful Library of Congress in Washington, D.C. I'm Bob Wise, President of the Alliance for Excellent Education and former Governor of West Virginia. Now, since Digital Learning Day started just this morning, let me read you some statistics that have already taken place. First of all, we've officially trended on Twitter. Good tweeting, everybody. More than 3,000 have registered for the virtual conference that's being played in schools, libraries, and classrooms across the United States. We had a contest for Hold Your Own Event. The state of Wisconsin is the winner with more than 300 events on our national map. Through Twitter, we have reached 2.3 million people in just the last few hours. 30,000 have engaged in Facebook, and over 1,000 have written their own commentary on what's happening right now today. And what is very significant to me is that we confidently estimate that based upon all of this, that more than 1.5 million teachers used a lesson, planned an event, or tried something new in celebration of Digital Learning Day. So thank you, America's teachers and principals and educators and superintendents. So what is digital learning? We define it as any instructional practice that makes effective use of the many types of technology to strengthen the student learning experience. This can include using data systems, interactive software, online courses, deploying internet access devices. And rather than lessening the role of teaching, digital learning elevates a teacher's role by giving teachers more strategies and resources to do what they do best, to teach. It's about using modern tools, such as robust digital content and student information systems. It's about engaging students to acquire the deeper learning competencies of creative thinking, project-based learning, and problem-solving that connects to the real world. It's about cutting-edge teacher training and new methods of assessment. And I'm pleased to be hosting today's national celebration with hundreds of educators who were nominated by their districts to join us. Also with us are education technology experts from more than 50 organizations representing teachers, principals, parents, community leaders, business organizations. And what is perhaps even more exciting is the participation from literally hundreds of thousands of educators joining us virtually from all 50 states in the District of Columbia and more than 100 countries. We may have a lot of schools out today across the East Coast and other parts of the country because of snow or ice or inclement weather, but we have a lot of learning that's taking place digitally. And we're thrilled for another reason as well, to be joined by nationally recognized journalist Judy Woodruff from the PBS NewsHour, who will be moderating today's discussion. Judy, thank you very, very much for being here.
I'm delighted to be here. I think everyone knows the emphasis that PBS places on education, on children, and making sure they get a good education. The PBS NewsHour, where I work every day, for us, there is no more important issue than education. It's something we spend a lot of time and a lot of energy thinking about the best way to cover it. So I'm really honored to be part of this conversation.
Well, thank you for making it happen. And of course, PBS, the entire system for decades, through technology, has been providing high-quality digital education.
That's right.
So the National Digital Learning Day, the hottest ticket in town on this chilly February day. And once again, schools closed across the country, but we're hearing great stories of kids doing science projects and collaborating on Digital Learning Day, even though it's a snow day. Now that's dedication. And for those of you joining us virtually, we're coming to your computer screens from one of the world's most prestigious learning institutions, our nation's library. The Library of Congress offers an incredible venue to showcase and talk about the power of digital learning. And of course, for those of you participating digitally on Twitter, we're in the Library of Congress, but you can still tweet, where we invite you to use the hashtag DLDay. You can also participate in the discussions using the chat box on this webpage. Now, it's been truly amazing to watch Digital Learning Day emerge from just a neat idea taking place in one elementary school to a massive teacher-led grassroots effort in 2 short years. We've made it because of the enthusiasm of committed educators who see firsthand the power of technology to improve instruction. And we're also grateful for the support of so many of you who represent the education community, the business community, community organizations, large companies, small companies, everyone joined together around this. Plus, all 50 states participating in Digital Learning Day, plus the District of Columbia, the Virgin Islands, have taken on the Digital Learning Day banner and developed their versions of the day with student showcases, special support for teachers, contests, and state recognition programs for leadership in digital education and digital learning. Truly, truly a great day.
It is a great day, and we are going to, at this point, we want to add what we think is an exciting addition, if you will, to the program. We have invited what we call our power panel to join us as we talk to educators. These are a group of individuals who have spent a lot of time, in fact, in many cases, their career, looking at education and thinking about ways it can address the needs and the aspirations of American children. So these are folks who are shaping educational technology, shaping the policies, in fact, that are going to affect the next decade of students. So let's right now invite up our power panel for Digital Learning Day. Please welcome them as I bring them up. First, Rich Crandall. He's director of the Wyoming Department of Education. Nice to meet you. Next, Lillian Lowery. She is Maryland State Superintendent of Schools. Next, we have Jessica Rosenworcel. She is Federal Communications Commission Commissioner, which, of course, is absolutely crucial when you think about the role that digital plays in the schools. Welcome. And also joining us, Jim Shelton, Deputy Secretary of the Department of the United States Department of Education. Welcome, Mr. Secretary. And I want to also add, of course, Bob, that will be joining us as
right
Congressman.
Here.
Is he coming in right
I
now?
I see what a distinguished figure coming down the aisle now.
Congressman George Miller, representative from the state of California, 11th Congressional District. Who has served 20th term in Congress. He has served as senior Democrat right now on the House Committee on Education and the Workforce.
So thanks, Judy. We've got our power panel in place. And so now let's start with the inspiring story of Talladega County Schools in Alabama. Now, for many of us, Talladega is a synonym for the world-famous Super Speedway. But Talladega County is turning heads for a different reason. The dramatic improvement of its students, the improvements they're making since its transition to a 21st century model that includes the effective use of technology. Prior to its digital learning transformation, Talladega County was known for high poverty and low academic performance. Today, this amazing district has become a nationally known hotbed for digital learning and for dramatically increasing the college and career readiness of its students. Just watch.
We wanted to infuse technology to support our students' learning.
The students were more engaged in their lessons.
The whole culture had shifted.
Poverty is very prevalent in Talladega County, I think, due to the lack of industry. This was the huge Avondale textile mill. I think everyone knows someone who's lost a job here at Avondale.
When he was a student at Winterboro, Daryl was a student at risk, a high needs child, trying to make it in a world of poverty. I mean, they're deemed homeless because you're just literally moving from one place to another.
Both my parents, they didn't finish high school. And I was in special education because of my hearing and my speech impediment. When the technology came in, I was one of the few people who knew how to use it. The computers gave me a new way to communicate with people, and it kind of broke me out of the shell. You know, I just blossomed down into, you know, a social butterfly, I guess I may say.
So the transformation from this quiet, shy child was through the culture shift at Winterboro, through the use of technology. Project-based learning has served not only Winterboro High School, but schools across Talladega County extremely well. We wanted to infuse technology to support our students' learning, and most importantly, we wanted to empower students to really own their learning, and we want our teachers to deliver instruction in new and meaningful ways. January of this coming year, we will actually have a one-to-one student-to-computer ratio in all of our high schools.
When you're done with the quiz,
each student has a MacBook Pro. They have the devices 24 hours. The way the technology ties in is now that they have a resource where they have limitless information at their fingertips.
Presenting a lesson traditionally has lost its effectiveness, and that's where project-based learning came, because now we can do it digitally. And now in geometry class we're saying, okay, how can building a bridge, how does that lead to other occupations? Then we provided them some apps that we found on the iPad. It allowed them to create different bridges and use different supplies or materials just so they could understand how a bridge needs to be structurally sound.
This is 150, so we've got the requirement, so good job on that.
The thing that sets Talladega County aside for me is the way they've gone about this entire process. They engaged their faculty, identified that they had an issue with student learning, brainstormed them all the various things they needed to do to shift their thinking about what teaching and learning looks like in the 21st century, and then decided how the technology fit into that process.
Talladega County school system is known statewide for our professional development, and we pride ourselves in the fact that our teachers are our primary leaders of our professional development.
I'm always humored when people ask me about teachers being on board.
Who's the voice of some kind of...
Because I don't see it that way.
Sometimes you have to provide...
You give them choice. You tell them, come up with a plan for students. How are you going to take them to the next level? When they design it, there's no need to try to figure out how to get someone on board. It's their design.
That's cool. All right. I want you to, in fractions, add each of these measures.
Opus is math and music. Every single lesson, it had to integrate math and music.
Can it be upside?
Project-based learning works best if you have like a marriage, two people working together, and oftentimes different content areas. Today, they were creating their rhythms using an iPad, iWrite Music app.
When I arrived at Winterboro, the students were 33% proficient on the Alabama reading and math test, and after a full year of implementation of Opus, they were at 72%. That told Mr. Lawrence and I that what we were doing was truly effective.
Kids want to come to school because they understand why they're doing what they're doing in class and has relevance to their lives. Even a rural system, even some of our poorest areas, can really transform teaching and learning if they begin with the right place.
Because you have it in that you're going to save for 27 months.
The access to technology at a high poverty school is so necessary. It evens the playing field for all of our students.
Good job.
Education-wise, to be at the bottom and then being in the top 10, it's pretty big for me. I got a full two-year scholarship to Central Alabama Community College. I believe that if I go on with my college education and get the job I wanted, you know, I'll, you know, break the cycle for, you know, poverty in my family.
Whoa.
So, Bob, that's a wonderful look inside a real school district where they really are implementing some of the things we're here to talk about today. We're very fortunate that some of the people we saw in that video are going to be joining us right now on stage, and let me introduce them. Talladega County School Superintendent Suzanne Lacey. Please come out. Let's welcome you. Digital Learning Specialist at Childersburg High School, Jennifer Barnett. And Amber Garrett. She is a student who experienced Talladega both before and after the transition. Amber?
So, Superintendent Lacey, if I could start, I was struck by a lot of things, but one of the things that Dr. Tommy Bice, the state superintendent, said was the importance of a strategy. And so, as the district leader, what makes this transformation so special, and what advice would you give to education leaders who may be facing similar challenges?
I think what really makes this so special to Talladega County and all of our people, our teachers and our students, is the fact that it has been built from the ground up. We certainly talked with our teachers early on to get their input as to how teaching and learning needed to change throughout Talladega County. As part of that, we also included our students because we knew that student leadership would be critical to any change that would take place across our district.
Well, I want to turn now to Jennifer. As we said, you're a digital learning specialist. As somebody who's seen this, as we just heard from the ground up, how has it changed the way you and others approach education, especially for those students who may be struggling?
Very good question, Judy. It changes everything. You are beginning to see your instruction through a completely different lens. Project-based learning and technology, when you combine these forces together, it's the equivalent in my mind, in terms of my instructional design, of a traditional instruction, which might be two-dimensional, and all of a sudden it's the fourth dimension. And it leverages opportunities for me as a teacher to design authentic, real-world application for learning, not just traditional lessons and traditional tests, but the measurements were just like what you see. Let's stand on the bridge. Will it hold you? If it doesn't, we've done something wrong. Let's go back to the drawing board and let's figure this out together. So it does change how you design instruction based on those types of experiences.
So when you say fourth dimension, what do you mean?
Well, I mean that it almost blows your mind what is available. I know that's what teachers tell me every day, is my mind is blown. The more I learn about this, the more I realize there's much more to know. And it's moving when you think flipped learning, when you see all of these other blended learning, these opportunities that are way beyond our regular classroom traditional approach to instruction. I don't truly mean that we're traveling through time, but but it feels like that to a classroom teacher. It truly feels like I have so much more I can be leveraging to serve students, especially those students that have been either underserved or for whatever reason are behind or struggling.
So, Jennifer, we at the Alliance for Excellent Education have been very fortunate to have you as one of our Alliance Project 24 experts, our planning process, in our efforts to support districts to plan systematically for digital learning. Now, you're constantly sharing great advice about culture and supporting teachers. You've been on webinars. I think you've been starring in our MOOC. What can you share about how to encourage reluctant teachers to bring them along or to help them collaborate like we saw in the Opus project and particularly where math and music are combined?
Well, my experience, Bob, is that teachers want to use their expertise to design instruction that matters, instruction that really makes the difference for students. And I find there is a natural curiosity to this process. For example, Mr. Lawrence and Ms. Harris at Winterboro, I noticed that they were very fascinated with the collaborative approach that existed in the school. There were English and history teachers and many others that were already working together. And I watched them watch, and they were so asking questions, fascinated, and they had not been on the early slate to do all of this. We were trying to take one step at a time. So all I did was put them in a room together and say, let's see what happens. And they naturally found those connections. They began to talk about this, and the only role I played was support and encouragement. And when they would make a suggestion, let me see if I can't help you make that happen. You need stuff to make musical instruments? Let's go find stuff. Whatever it is that I need to do. And what I see is more and more teachers are looking for that type of open-minded opportunity to be provided to them.
All right, let's hear from the student. Amber, we're so glad you're here with us today. You're someone who experienced the schools before this trend, this digital innovation, what's happening now, and after. What are the differences you've seen, and how much of a difference did it make for you?
For me personally, it made a tremendous difference. And overall, for the school as an entire student body, it had quite an incredible positive change on all of us. And I feel like if it had not been for our teachers willing to trust us and work together with us to achieve a goal that we had all set together, it would not have been as successful as it was. And as a result of that, our graduation rates increased tremendously. And, I mean, we're known nationwide now and for being the best at what we do, so it's been great.
Can you give us something to mention? Can you just give us an example of a learning experience that was better and more meaningful for you as a result of this digital change?
As a result of this, I've definitely been able to be more open-minded to trying new things and trusting new things and trusting myself being able to do them. And I've been blessed to have many opportunities such as this, as being able to communicate well with others. And if it had not been for project-based learning, I feel like I wouldn't have been prepared for that. And I've definitely been prepared for college as well.
Well, we know that all three of you have had so much, you've learned so much, you've shared only a part of it with us today. We want to thank you for what you've brought, and let's give them all a hand for participating.
So, Judy, the Talladega story reminds us that digital learning is really much broader to me than any particular aspect of technology. It's not just about online learning or data or whatever. It's all of it. And it's how you blend it, how you bring it together. It's also how it helps students learn concepts more deeply while taking ownership. And Amber, you spoke about this, taking ownership of their learning. It also shows how critical teachers and libraries are to the success in digital learning. And of foremost importance, of course, is that this kind of instruction is happening within public schools, especially those with the highest need, and a means of ensuring that all of our students have the opportunity to succeed. So at this point, it's a good chance to turn to our power panel to see, to get their thoughts on this.
Well, and as we said, we're so fortunate to have these five individuals who have spent their careers in different ways focusing on education. I'm going to start with you, Ms. Rosenworcel, and ask you about the fact that, you know, you hear, when you see what's going on in a place like the Talladega system, what do you take away from it? What is the success that the rest of the country should take from that and want to emulate?
Well, first thing, I think I want to draw some attention to the amazing success they've had with their graduation rates. Just a few years ago, Talladega County had a graduation rate of 63%. That's now 88%. So, you know, that doesn't just merit applause. I want to learn more about how technology has fueled that increase. And in particular, how E-Rate, which is a program that I work on extensively at the FCC, and helps connect low-income schools across the country. I want to learn about how that program has helped connect Talladega County schools.
In Talladega County, geographically, we're a very long county. From north to south, it's a 60-mile radius. And without the support of E-Rate funding, it would be impossible, truly impossible, to do what we have done in Talladega County. So thank you for your incredible efforts and what you're continuing to do, because we have greater dreams and greater expansion in the plan. So just to say that it's made a difference is really an understatement. It has made a significant difference. And we so value the service because we could not continue to expand what we want to do for our students. The power of technology is tremendous in a rural system, as it is anywhere across the nation. And I think most importantly, it's really given our students a vision for their future. They're able to connect to the world now, whereas before they were in the confines of their own community. And because of this incredible transformation that we've experienced, our students are now really seeking opportunities about their colleges and careers, and truly impacted their lives in ways that are extraordinary.
Congressman Miller, you've spent your life working to advance the interests of low-income children and those that are traditionally underserved. And I guess you've got a question.
Yeah, I have spent my life doing that, and during that time, I've been amazed at the road to education hell is paved by 3 and 5 year demonstration programs, and in watching these videos over the weekend, I was quite taken one with the planning time, but I think the sense that this is a permanent change. This isn't permanent, but this is a permanent change that will continue to evolve. And just listening to the snippets between the teachers and the students and back and forth, it seems that you're using that permanency, that this is the new now, to wring out the gaps and the deficits in both the teaching and the learning environment. And there seems to be this buy-in that this is the way it's going to be going forward, whether there'll be adaptations. But this doesn't end in 2 years or 5 years. And I asked, Daryl came up about 5 times from my wife, and I said, not during the Super Bowl, but then later I said, oh, let's go ahead and you can talk. There's nothing going on here anyway. But you can see how this works when you have that buy-in that we rarely get in demonstration programs and three-year experiments and that sort of thing. I just don't know if you want to discuss that.
I think I really refer to that as systemic change, and to truly have systemic change, you have to have buy-in, and it's a process. We are really on year 6. I often refer to that as chapters of the book, and when we were creating this book, the very first year, we knew exactly how we wanted it to look like and what we wanted in terms of student outcomes, and every year it just gets better, and our leaders throughout our school district, our principals, teachers, and students have just been there every step of the way planning and tweaking the process. So it is a work in progress, but the results speak for themselves, and we truly are extremely proud of what's happening and that we can serve as a model for others throughout our state and also our nation now.
Thank you.
I want to include, bring in all the panel, but first maybe hear from the two state school leaders. Lillian Lowery, as we said, she's the superintendent of schools in Maryland. Rich Crandall, director of the Department of Education in Wyoming. And Lillian, I'll turn to you first. As you hear about the experiences of what they've done in Alabama in this particular school system, what application is there that for other school systems, for states like Maryland?
The real benefit in doing what they're doing in Talladega that I find is that it individualizes and customizes learning for students like we have never, ever been able to do before, and that information and that methodology is portable. So while students are engaged in learning how to use these technologies to enhance how they learn and how they grow, that transfers to home and other learning opportunities. It doesn't become a static place for learning. Listening to the students speak and talk about how this transformed things for her and her colleagues, including graduation rates, meaning more people were more engaged. That's what we want. If students are going to be college and career ready, we can no longer have them in little narrow places learning discrete knowledge. They have to inform their learning and growing through their analytical thinking skills so that learning does follow them where they go. And when I watched the video this weekend, I thought, what a wonderful way to make the statement to people that it isn't about poverty, it isn't about where people live, it is about the opportunities that we give them.
Amber, you're nodding your head. What are you thinking?
I couldn't agree more. she has a point. Everything that she just said, it makes total sense, and I feel like everything that she just brought to you guys' attention is what we're trying to show the world by doing it, through project-based learning in Alabama.
Superintendent Crandall, what are you thinking at this
point? I want to go back to earlier this morning. Governor Bob Weiss made a statement where he said, to move to digital learning, you kind of have to give up some control. The teacher does. And then Amber said a phrase that really caught my ear. She said, thanks for trusting us.
That's right.
Can you expound on that just a little bit? Because I promise you, in Wyoming, we talk about rural districts, but we also have frontier districts, which are even really small. But I guarantee the same principles can apply in Wyoming. What does that mean, thanks for trusting us?
At the beginning, when we first started project-based learning, we all were learning new things, the teachers and the students. And, you know, it couldn't have been more successful if we had not been willing to try things. And our teachers, they really didn't know much. So we were all like, well, I mean, they knew, but they weren't as tech savvy. You know? They weren't as tech savvy.
I love the honesty.
We're glad you clarified.
You're getting home to Alabama.
So after that, we all just learned things together, and they trusted us to bring information and resources to them, and we trusted them to be able to, you know, work with us and learn together. And I'm so glad that they were open to trusting us and being able to, you know, be more open-minded for different things.
Secretary Shelton, Jim Shelton from the U.S. Department of Education, you look at these issues all over the country. What do you think?
First thing I have to do, unfortunately, is say acting. I am still just an acting.
You don't act at anything.
Actually, one of the things that I am intrigued with is different people want to approach the change process differently. And you all did something very interesting, which is you decided you're going to change your pedagogical approach at the same time as you introduced a new set of tools. So would you talk about that decision and then what's been good about it and what the challenges have been with getting people to think very differently about instruction and differently about the tool set they have available to them? And actually, has that newness helped?
Well, I'll speak to it from a teacher and a support person for a teacher's perspective in terms of the kind of information that we addressed with our leaders, because the decisions actually are made in conjunction with teachers. And that's probably the first and most important point to make, is that when decisions are made, it's a very much of a collective body. But what we realized is there has to be a purpose. There has to be a purpose every day for every class, for every lesson, for everything that you're doing. And while devices are cool and fun and interesting and intriguing, and we might not know how to use them, but they're very attractive, that is not the purpose. The purpose of learning comes right back to our learning targets and our goals and really studying what do those mean. And it made natural sense that we can move at warp speed, working within that context, once we include technology with this. It's a natural instinct for students to use these tools. And if we are willing to truly open ourselves up, like Amber says, that's how we can accomplish this. But it takes a commitment from other leaders to implement that.
All right, as we wrap up this part of the conversation, Congressman Miller, Ms. Rosenworcel, either one of you have a thought about how Talladega, the school system there, has made this a reality.
Well, it's so impressive. I mean, in terms of, you know, we're always looking for the data, and we're all in the world of measuring success and the rest of that. But to me, more importantly, was just, again, in the clips, was seeing the students working together. The collaboration, I guess, is what to me, I find there's such a multiplier in it going forward, whether, you know, from class to class and from student group to student group. And it appears that you're on track to keep this together, you know, to grow it, to change it, but this is the direction that works for the students, and that's very exciting to see. It really is.
Ms. Rosenworcel, final comment here?
You know, it's apparent to me from where I work that we live in the digital age. But what strikes me is so many classrooms are stuck in the industrial age. Mm-hmm. And I think it's terrific that you've decided to wrestle with new technology and find a lot of good there, because I think you're better preparing your students for the economy and the world that they'll enter.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Great.
Thank you. Great. So thank you very much, Suzanne and Jennifer and Amber. We're trying to learn all the time. But thank you for traveling to Washington, D.C. From Alabama. And as you said, Amber, your story is inspiring school leaders across the U.S. as they embark on digital learning. Thank you for being with us today.
Thank you.
So right now we're going to, and we want to thank them again, we want to introduce two additional dynamic school leaders. These are district leaders. They are, and I'm going to bring them out one by one, Superintendent Mary Ellen Elia from Hillsborough County Public Schools in Florida. Please come on out. And the Assistant Superintendent for Learning and Leadership from Henry County Schools in Georgia, Aaron Schmuel. So we're going to talk to them in just a moment, but first we want you to see this video that Mr. Schmuel brought about blended learning strategies in Henry County. Let's watch.
My name is Lauren, and I'm a student in Henry County Schools. My school is so cool. It is not like other schools. I work on real-world projects, work that matters. I get to use my computer to help me get work done, and I get more time with my teachers in small groups.
I'm Darius, and I love my school because I get to show teachers what I already know and keep on moving. I really hate sitting around listening to stuff I already know and waiting on other kids. If I ever get stuck, I have the flexibility to get help when I need it. My teachers call it personalized learning.
This year, my students are working at different paces and in different ways. As a teacher, it's exciting to see them so engaged in schoolwork. I can create small groups that provide individual help on each student's biggest challenges. I can even accelerate students who are ready to move on, while providing more opportunities for students who need longer, more individualized attention, without worrying about lesson plans. I actually have more time to do what I do best, make sure the kids are learning.
You know, as a parent, I can't believe how active my son is in school. I've never seen anything like it. He takes responsibility for his work, and he's proud of what he creates. He gets the same satisfaction in school that I do completing a big project at work. With the learning profile and parent portal, I know more about him in school than I ever did. I really love where this is headed.
Personalized learning is awesome. I'm learning so much great stuff in school, like how to design and experiment. The cool thing is that we actually get to solve real-world problems with those experiments. I get to do group work when it helps and move at my own pace when it helps. I feel like I am in control of my learning.
I'm great at writing, so this year, I have a blog where I lead discussions about protecting the environment. My teacher even gave me an A for it. It's great to get school credit for creating stuff I care about. I always know what I have to do to move on.
Teaching in Henry County makes me proud of our schools and our students. We have a community of learners and creators who are equipped with the skills they need to be ready for challenging colleges and careers in the 21st century. I can't wait to watch them change the world.
So Aaron, first of all, I want to know who the artist is who's doing it.
I'd like to say it was one of our students, but we actually had that professionally done for us.
Okay, the truth came out. We could replace television. It was very good. Tell us about, in a nutshell, clearly you've done some really exciting things, but tell us about the challenges that you had to overcome to get to where you are right now.
So the video that you saw really talks about all the partnerships that we have in place between parents and kids and teachers. And so one of the challenges in this digital learning work that we're doing is getting all the different stakeholders on the same page and understanding the work that we're doing. And so there are really three big challenges. Number one is we're changing the role of teachers. You know, teachers used to be the place where kids went to get information, and now teachers are the place where kids go to learn how to use information. And the technology replaces the idea of getting information and makes it so teachers have to really push hard on showing how to use things. Secondly, the digital technology has given parents more access to information about their kids than they've ever had before, and that's a little bit scary. Most parents send their kids to school and trust that teachers are going to treat their kids well and make sure that they learn. And now we're able to give them so much more information about their child through digital platforms.
What's an example of that?
So an example of that is in our learning management system, a parent gets an email every single morning from the platform that says, this is what your child completed yesterday, this is how much work that they did, this is how they scored on that work yesterday. And then, so they get information on the progress of their child, but they also then have the opportunity to do some work with their child at home, taking advantage of the technology.
And that's every day.
That's every day, which is amazingly overwhelming for lots of parents. It's also really, really helpful, but it's also very overwhelming. And so that's a challenge. And then the third challenge that we've had in doing all this work, and one that we've talked about here already extensively today, is access. We have these great tools that can do all of those things that we just talked about. But kids need to have access both at school in a way that they can take advantage of those tools, and then they also need it at home. And so those are the two big challenges. And our community has really come together to help address some of those, passing some bond referendums and things like that to help support access. But it's still a challenge as we move forward and an opportunity for us as well.
So as we saw in these examples, when school leaders re-examine the way we've always done it, they're able to overcome a lot of issues that used to be serious obstacles to reform, including limited teacher time, budget cuts, lackluster student engagement, outdated teacher training, rigid textbooks, and lack of useful data. So these often aren't policy constraints as much as they're system constraints. And what you have to do, and what we're seeing in successful districts, is how they've managed to address them, confront them, and not work within the same paradigms. So as school leaders forge this path, they're able to work together with the whole community to support student learning. One district that I've been watching for a long time is Hillsborough County, Florida, is a great example of how digital learning can support college and career readiness, and how technology is used to connect the whole community. Let's watch.
One of the biggest challenges facing our schools is that students often don't see the real-life applications for what they're being taught in class. In Hillsborough County, Florida, students are tackling real-world problems in class and using technology in school and at home to become college and career ready. Here at Burnett Middle School in Sefner, just outside of Tampa, Francis Perez works with students every day, helping them to develop marketable skills. They can get high school level credit and earn industry certification in Microsoft Excel, Word, PowerPoint, and other programs. Ms. Perez teaches a class called Computing for College and Careers.
They come in every day. We start out the lesson where I do sort of like a demonstration, and then we do an assessment. The nice thing about the whole process is they can take this home and do additional studies if they need to. They can log into the website anytime, anywhere that they want to.
It's actually doing a lot for me because I'm learning a lot on the computer and definitely a lot more than what I knew before I came into this class, and I really like the program that we've been learning too. I actually use it at home a lot.
Ms. Perez came to us a couple years ago, and she's been doing a phenomenal job. The students are engaged. She brings energy and passion for learning into her classroom.
As busy as the students are when they're in Francis Perez's class, the lessons don't end at the classroom door.
The last time I used this was actually for a different subject in school. I used it to make graphs in Excel and then transfer it over to Word where I could print it more effectively.
I learned that using Excel, you can organize everything else for specific reasons in different businesses and whatever you use and achieve a lot.
When Hillsborough first established the Microsoft IT Academies in 2012, the first step was getting teachers trained. It's not easy for an adult to stay ahead of the teenagers when it comes to technology, so training was essential. Now, the academies have been established in 67 schools district-wide. This program also promotes parent and family engagement. Hillsborough County encourages parents and family members to work toward earning their Microsoft certifications using the resources from the Microsoft IT Academy.
So Mary Ellen Ely, again, Superintendent of Schools in Hillsborough, this video is from. One of the things you talked about there and you've talked to us about is it's important not just what goes on in the classroom, but to have partnerships to make sure families are engaged. But you've also talked about libraries and other community institutions. Tell us a little bit more about how that, why that's important.
Well, the video you just saw really encourages families whose students are getting certifications in Microsoft across the board, starting as early as middle school and into high school, to become involved. So that's an important part of it. But in Hillsborough, we've taken community partnerships very, very seriously. We have great relationships with the not-for-profits like the United Way, the Boys and Girls Club, the YMCA, as well as Tampa Housing Authority and others who have all contributed. And in any student in Hillsborough County from birth to eighth grade has access to online thousands of books that they can read. So in Hillsborough County, that has allowed us to then move outside of a school to the libraries where they're all available, funded through our Hillsborough County public library system, into our homes where our students might be in the public housing. And in each of their homes, they're providing a computer, and our students have access to those books. We have had more than 34 million books read. And on top of that, we have our students constantly accessing these online resources from their handheld devices, from anywhere that they want to go. And it's not just for public schools. It's the important thing that all children in our community should have access to resources. And in the digital world that we face and that we're part of, those are all a doable thing. So it's a huge part of what we do in our community to say this is an important thing for all of our children. If you can read, you have broken down so many barriers to your learning and your success, and that makes all the difference.
Well, it's fascinating to see what you've done. I want to come back to our power panel now and come to you, our school, our state school leaders, Lillian Lowery, Maryland. As you listen to what the experiences are, not only in Hillsborough County, Florida, but Henry County, Georgia, what do you see, what do you think, and are these, again, are there lessons there taking away that you think apply to other school systems?
Absolutely, and I think what most intrigues me is that not only is Hillsborough using technology to provide opportunities for students, but also to parents to earn industry-recognized certificates. Mm-hmm. That is really amazing. Can you elaborate more on the programs that you're using to help students catch up while ensuring that they are ready for college and or career?
Sure. So many times students get behind. You know, they might make a bad choice. They get unconnected with home or school, and so they've got to be able to connect and reconnect and make up work. We have a number of programs that we work with. Agile Mind is an Algebra 1 program that we've had an enormous amount of success with, and we're really changing the way our teachers are engaging students in mathematics skills. We also have programs for our gifted students. We use a Renzulli program that helps us to expand the students' minds who are anxious and want to look at things differently because that's just their nature, and we use that as extensions. We also have programs that we use. For instance, the Read 180 is a huge support for students who have had difficulties in reading, and we really want to bring them forward. So our My On Reader program is to get every kid reading by third grade so that they can learn to read successfully and then read to learn. And then we go the next step in saying, okay, we haven't caught everybody up. What do we need to do next?
Rich Crandall, Wyoming State School Superintendent. You've been anxious to ask a question.
I have, and as Director of Education. But Bob, I want to tell you the power of Digital Learning Day, and Mary Ellen will not remember this, but what goes around comes around. 2 years ago, when I was a state senator in Arizona, I learned about Hillsborough. Made arrangements to go visit there and spend the day Hillsborough, seeing innovation live in practice. 2 weeks ago, I was at Microsoft, where we are rolling out the Microsoft IT Academy with the support of Governor Matt Mead in Wyoming. We're rolling it out statewide. And so it may take a little while. 2 years seemed like a long time. I didn't even live in Wyoming until 7 months ago. But it is interesting. I appreciate so much you sharing things. I've been to Hall County, Georgia, to see some great things. Sounds like Henry County will be next.
And well, let's come back to acting Deputy Secretary Jim Shelton. You're hearing what they're dealing with. How does this apply, and what can other school systems learn from this?
Well, actually, that's the question I want to ask you. You know, from the Department of Education, we had Race to the Top District, which was specifically to try and help systems figure out how to do personalization at scale. Many of you have kind of started along this pathway without the benefit of federal resources. So I have two questions for you. One is, how are you systemically thinking about personalization, and how does this technology help you do that? The second is, we're about to come out with a letter of guidance about all the different ways you can use federal resources to help with this, but you all figured it out on your own. So I'd love you to hear talk about how you paid for some of this stuff as well.
You know, we look at personalized learning as an instructional philosophy about how we meet kids where they are, and then give them what they need, how they need it, and when they need it. And we think about it as really giving teachers the power to be able to make decisions about what kids need when they need it. And they can't do that with class sizes of 25 or 32 or 35 or whatever class sizes you might have unless they have the support of technology. And so Henry County has focused on finding platforms first that are so compelling that they help teachers to be able to figure out how to do that and help them manage paperwork, help them create efficiencies, as well as extending the school day for kids. And so we've worked really hard with some vendors to kind of create relationships where they're flexible and they work with us and we work with them. And really looking at having a clear instructional philosophy before we laid money on the line to say this is what we need the platform to do, not just buying a program because it was out there. So we've been able to stretch our dollars that way by having that really strong instructional philosophy standing up behind any use of technology before we jump into it. So that's really how we do it. And then I think also she's mentioned the community really supporting things like in the libraries, and we've had really strong community support with our bond referendum. I think if school systems can make a compelling case that this type of learning is better, it's more interesting, more engaging, and it's going to move kids down to a better place, then communities will come and support as well.
And so from the perspective of our community work, when I say that we have the Mayan Reader program available for all students birth through eighth grade, both fiction, nonfiction, in English and in Spanish, all of that is because we all contributed money. The school system has the biggest chunk of that support, but we have the Housing Authority, we have the public libraries, we have our partners with the United Way, and they have put money in to support this countywide effort. I think that everybody in a community has to be focused on what their part is, and everybody needs to put skin in the game here. And they have to make sure that when this is important enough and it's for our children, we have to move that direction. And it's not a question of should we, it's how we're going to do it, when we're going to do it, and let's make it happen. And 2 years is too long, but it happens, doesn't it?
So to the whole panel, and when you hear her say skin in the game, what are you thinking?
Well, I'm very excited about the announcement by the president that we're going to put skin in the game and bring the capacity, the internet capacity, broadband capacity to schools, to what, 15,000 years schools. That's very exciting because in my district, there's a lot of schools that don't have access to any of this. We pirate a little bit now and then, and they get a little bit of access, but they certainly aren't connected to the family. They may have it in the classroom, but it's not in the school. I mean, it's just a real problem. And yet you see when you're a full-fledged adopter of this attitude and this technology, you see all of the persistent problems that we lament over in education start to get greatly diminished, and they seem to be getting diminished at the hands of the students about their persistent gaps and deficits, teachers, their persistent gaps and deficits, and across schools and neighborhoods, the persistent gaps and deficits that are there that haunt us all of the time when you start talking, as Jim does so very often, about equity. And now you see the ability to include these students. And it kind of reminds me, if you go back and look at the business journals in the 1990s, corporation after corporation said, we bought all these computers and nothing's happened. Nothing's changed. Where's the return on the investment? And then when the connections happen, so now you're connecting the students and the teachers and teachers to other teachers and to the home and to the community, and you're getting this response, and now we're starting to see what is really now possible to get rid of these really persistent problems that we have failed to answer in a policy context in even the state legislatures and in the Congress.
Anybody want to respond to that? And I have one question that I'd love for you to address, and that is the rapid move to mobile devices and whether the school systems are able to keep up with that, and does it matter?
Well, you know, I really and I want to thank you for the work that you've done because you've been a strong advocate across the board, so it really makes a difference for all of us. I think the one thing that is really critical is it can't be one group. It can't be just government, and it can't be just the state. And you know, this has been a tough time for citizens in this country, and we can't keep going out and asking for increases in taxes. Those things are just not reasonable. What we've got to do is figure this out, that as communities working on these things, we can make this happen, and we have to all be involved in it. And so there's no one group that's responsible, but we all are. And I think that is really starting to be seen as the only way to really make this happen. Business groups need to get on the page here because they aren't going to have the workers they want. And all of us need to contribute. But I really appreciate the work that you have done.
Just really quickly, I was going to echo that point. I mean, one of the things that was exciting about the announcement the president made yesterday about increasing connectivity across the country is you had the FCC stepping up and doing its part, mm-hmm. actually doing it without having to go out and get more resources right away, saying we found some resources that we have here and we get a jump start on this process. But also you had businesses come to the table and say, you know what, some of us are going to give some things away that are going to give us opportunities for more of these pilots. But then you had some companies say, no, we're going to actually make a structural change. We're going to reduce our pricing for every school in the country so that it makes it so that every school in this country can actually get on board. When we see companies making that kind of transformational change where they're willing to say, we're going to forego a bunch of profit in the education space to get the transformation, the change to happen more quickly, I think we're going to start to see a real adoption increase across the country. And it'll let especially the students who need it the most get it.
Aaron, do you want to comment on that as we wrap this up?
Yeah, I think anything that the different vendors out there can do to help schools to get the technology in the hands of kids is important. There was an analogy about that Jim used about putting a computer on every desk for kids, and mobile technology really makes that happen. And so being able to do that for all of our kids, no matter where they come from, no matter what their mom or dad does for a job or what their experiences are, being able to put it in their hands allows us as the educators then to teach them how to use it in ways that will make them soar. And I think that's the exciting part about this work.
I think the teachers, too, are critical to this. Our teachers want to be able to use all of these different tools, and the more quickly that we can move on this, the more, and I appreciate so much the work being done by FCC because that will make that happen, but the handhelds that every kid has, we need to really take advantage of that involvement and have access to the Internet with them in schools, and that's happening, and that's what's going to just take off.
So, Judy, I'd like to say, pick up on something Congressman Miller said, which is full-scale adoption. And that's what both these districts plus Talladega have done, is it's full-scale, it's not piecemeal, it's strategic and thought out. And so I want to thank both Hillsborough and Henry County for making it possible, coming forward and talking with us today. So let's give them a round of applause. And also, I want to thank Judy Woodruff. We have one more segment, but Judy Woodruff has a national newscast to prepare for tonight. And so, Judy, thank you because
thank you
drew out exactly what we were hoping and even more from all of us, the best of what digital learning is about in education.
Well, all these stories are important to us at the NewsHour, and I just want to say it's a subject we pay attention to every day. Send us your stories. If you're doing something, whether it's in a county, a state, nationally, if you have ideas, please send them to the PBS NewsHour. It's my honor to participate today. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good to see you.
So we have one more segment. If I can keep the power panel, as many of you as possible here. And so it's widely known that successful educational practices only happen when and we've heard it here today, when teachers and parents are engaged in this process. So to cast a broader view of this important connection, I'd like to ask you to join me in welcoming now Otha Thornton, president of the National Parent Teacher Association, and Paul Toner. Otha, please. Let's see. Paul. And Paul Toner, president of the Massachusetts Teachers Association. Both of these are leaders nationally and in their respective areas for digital learning. And so, Otha, if I could start with you, can you tell us what your organization is doing in digital learning? And since you've come on board, it's doing a lot.
Well, thank you very much for having us here today. One of the things that National PTA has done is we've taken the lead through our National Family Reading Experience Program powered by Kindle. And we're embracing a comprehensive digital learning and advocating for the use of these programs. One of the things this thing does, it allows a child to have a 1,000 book library at their disposal. And we just know the importance of that, and we're encouraging our schools and teachers and principals to embrace the technology and advocating for the funding to get this technology to our schools.
And thank you. And strengthening that home-to-school connection is paramount, especially, and we've heard about the different efforts underway in various districts, but especially in the early grades. So I want to commend your leadership on this particular area. I'd just like to ask Paul, in observing you, you're not only a teacher leader, you're a union leader, and you've really stressed digital learning and the importance in the teaching profession. Could you talk a little bit about what digital learning means to you?
Sure. Now, you don't know who to attribute the quote to, but I remember seeing one quote that, the technology is not going to ever replace teachers, but teachers who understand how to use technology effectively will replace teachers who don't. I think we're in a very changing time, and many new teachers are, digital natives, and they understand using the technology. People like myself, sort of mid-career, need the opportunity to be trained in all these new tools. But we have to have time and quality training on how to use them. We also, and I want to thank the congressmen and state legislators in Massachusetts, we need the infrastructure, the access to the internet connectivity in all of our schools. And we also have to make sure that all students and teachers have access to the hardware and good software needed. And we need to give teachers time. I, again, agree with the congressman when he said this is about parents, students, and teachers all connecting around it. Back in the 90s, computers were put in the classroom, but nobody knew what to do with them. One of the things we're doing in Massachusetts and at NEA is providing more and more teachers with opportunities to share, both in person, but also through ed chats and unconferences and other opportunities. And one last thing that we're doing in Massachusetts and through NEA is partnering with groups like Better Lesson on providing teachers with a platform to share their learnings and their Common Core state standard lessons with one another.
So parents and teachers and now in working together, critically important. So to the panel, any last thoughts and reflections?
Bob, if you don't mind, I'm asking a question. As we look to expand digital learning in Wyoming, one of our challenges, and you just mentioned it, Paul, was the retraining of teachers. I'm fortunate I have tremendous support of the legislature and the governor, even formed a teacher's cabinet recently to come in and talk to us about that. But as you've experienced this, what has worked well for you as you retrain teachers to be effective users of technology?
They're actually training me as I go out and talk to teachers. In fact, we did surveys of our teachers 2 years ago, and there was an awful lot more going on with technology in our schools than we ever realized. In fact, we found that out of the 350 school districts in Massachusetts, almost 200 were already using virtual high school and providing at least some part of high school courses online. Teachers are getting an awful lot of their professional development now, not through sitting in an auditorium professional development lecture series, but actually teachers tweeting one another and sharing articles and YouTube clips and all sorts of other things. So they're actually learning from one another, and I'm now learning from them, and we're trying to help provide more opportunities and share that learning.
One of the things that, again, resonated with me with Hillsborough County is that parents have been engaged and have sent the same opportunities that students do to kind of hone their technology skills. The PTA is really powerful in that you can get to an audience sometimes that we in schools can't. That is the hardest piece that we have. It's communication with parents, educating parents, and helping them come on board. So are you working with your state leaders to make sure that they are engaged in ways that they will be thinking about engaging in schools and helping students understand the sense of urgency around technology and how that impacts their futures?
Yes, ma'am. Like I say, with our national family reading experience, just an example, when we're reaching out to some of the underserved communities, particularly in these areas, and expanding. But what we do is it brings families in, and they really are enjoying it. And we're sharing these experiences with our other, state leaders around the country. And again, we're seeing positive movement towards this parental engagement that we want. And we're seeing improvement as we move forward.
And I would just maybe be in touch with you to see where that's working well.
Yes, ma'am.
I mean, it's working in places in our state, but yes, we need best practices around that.
Maryland's number one, though, right?
I know. Well, we share it with Paul.
Commissioner Rosenworcel.
Okay. One of the things that I think a lot about in my job at the FCC is the digital divide. Those households that don't have access to the internet are not on broadband. And one of the cruelest components of the digital divide is the homework divide. Because studies show that about 75% of teachers now assign homework that requires some access to the internet. So imagine what it's like to be a student who can't do their homework because their family doesn't have that access, or can't apply for a scholarship because doing it on a smartphone isn't so easy. So I wonder what you've been thinking about with respect to that, because in addition to bringing it to the schools, making sure those students have it at home or in a place like a library is essential for the new digital learning experience.
Well, I think what we have been advocating for is more access to the hardware through their schools, and in fact, a number of schools in Massachusetts, through either their own budgets or grants that they've received, have been getting one-on-one iPads for their students that they're allowed to take home with them. More and more schools are providing greater access after the regular school day hours for students to have access to the school computer labs. But I do think, at least the trend I'm seeing in Massachusetts, is that more and more schools are going to the one-to-one model of providing hardware for students.
I would say a couple of things. Like you say, again, access through their through the public school systems, public libraries are very important. And then PTA, we advocate for that. But there are also, I've been to some states, for example, West Virginia, that does not have the infrastructure to do it. So, again, that's a challenge that we look at. How do we overcome this? And I think it goes back to advocating for them to invest in the infrastructure in these public places where, the schools, faith groups are usually the center of these communities. So those are some things that we're looking at.
I mean, what occurs to me just listening to the entire conversation is obviously the recognition that high-speed connectivity and digital devices are now part of the basic tool set for the 21st century. Mm-hmm. So that's the obvious point. But the themes I took from the day are around courage to try things and let people fail and let people succeed by doing things differently. Trust, mutual trust, not only of the people in charge of the system, but teacher to teacher, student to student, and parent all the way around. And then shared learning, where everyone is actually learning from everyone as we go through this transformation. This is probably going to be one of the most profound transformations that we'll see for some time when we get it right. But getting there is going to require all three of those things, especially if we try and do it quickly.
So let's thank this power panel for their contribution and our representatives from parents and teachers. So I want to comment. You didn't think you were getting by with a remark about West Virginia without a comment. So you illustrate something, and the whole panel does, is the need for a strategy, and that's what this day has been about, a strategy that embraces where you are, where you live, and what you need. And for many of our areas, and Director Crandall, I think Wyoming may fall in, have some of the same access difficulties as well. I remember interviewing a superintendent one time who said, call us rural. He said, we're 100 miles from the closest Walmart. But what I mean by that is there may not be, until Commissioner Rosenworcel can get us that E-rate, which he's working on so hard, we may not have that connectivity at home like we want it for all of our students. So what's the technology then that can we do, what can we do with those one-to-one devices and send those students home with? Just as you were talking about the books that you've got on, 1,000 books on an access device, what kind of interactive software would a school need that perhaps isn't as relevant to another institution? What kind of training does that teacher need or that principal in one school that perhaps not so in another? We come in, that's the beauty of technology, is it meets us where we are and we try to shape, and then we also define what we want. And that's always been the history of technology as it's evolved, is it's made us a force multiplier, whether in the military or in education or in industry. It's permitted us to look at our situation and to figure out how to adapt the technology so that we can truly be better than what we were. So where there's problems with access, what does technology offer as an alternative? So that's why the Alliance really created Digital Learning Day, because we wanted to celebrate great teachers, school leaders, students, educators, policymakers, and such as the ones we've seen today. And as we visited schools across the country, we were amazed at the student success stories that we've heard. Think of Daryl in Talladega County, the shy student. Remember him? He was occasionally homeless and at risk of dropping out. And so with the help of dedicated and supportive teachers, digital tools, project-based learning that built his confidence and a strategy underlying it all, Daryl became, in his own words, a social butterfly. And he's now attending Central Alabama Community College on a full scholarship. So Daryl, as he said as well, is breaking the cycle of poverty in his family. But for every success story such as Daryl, there are still countless students who lack access to these powerful learning opportunities. And that's why I think 2014 is so important and why I'm going to be so excited about the fourth annual Digital Learning Day a year from now, at what we're going to be able to say we've accomplished. Because Commissioner Rosenworcel, what you're working on and the rest of the FCC in terms of E-rate and what the chairman announced today as far as moving forward and the opportunity to connect, to put a down payment down, as the president says, on 15,000 schools, 20 million students, that's phenomenal. And Acting Deputy Secretary Shelton, you've been one of the leaders in innovation in the 99 and 5 campaign that the president's talked about, and Connect Ed, and all that's taking place there, and Congressman Miller, who had to leave for votes. And so that's why the Federal Communications Commission Chairman Tom Wheeler's message from earlier this morning was so important during the first webcast about E-rate modernization. Why the remarks of Roberto Rodriguez were so important, and Director Crandall and Superintendent Lowery, what you're doing in each of your states, and it's exciting to see across all 50 states, the District of Columbia, the territories. Just as the construction of the interstate highway system opened vast opportunities in the United States for commerce, so it is that high-speed broadband offers similar potential to empower school leaders to deploy more digital learning strategies. What are we going to get done in this next year before the next annual Digital Learning Day? I think we're going to see major action in the FCC. I did some calculations just recently about the number of one-to-one devices that school districts are purchasing. We've hit we're way past the tipping point. I look at the interactive software, I look at the data systems, and so clearly decisions are being made in all 15,000 school districts in 50 states and the federal government that are completely changing education, but of course it's all being driven by the demand of the student and the need of the student. So we ask you to help as well, which you, of course, by being here, by participating virtually, you already have done. But we ask you to add your name in support of ensuring that more schools are connected with high-speed access. You can do this very easily. Just visit 99in5.org. And so, once again, I want to thank all those who've participated, our power panel, the educators, our students, the studio guests, Judy Woodruff and Public Broadcasting System, and also the executives from more than 50 national core partners and 25 corporate sponsors that have made this possible. To those watching virtually, I really want you to thank me in thanking InExpo, our virtual conference provider, for the robust online presentation. And as we draw to a close, I want you to remember one thing from today. The looks on the students' faces in those videos that we watched The conversation that we heard today, the look on Amber's face from Talladega County, Alabama. They were happy, they were engaged, they were collaborating with their classmates. And most importantly, they were excited about learning. And when you're excited about learning, you are learning. That's the potential that digital learning has in America's schools and classrooms. That's the potential we need to unlock to ensure that all students are prepared for success after high school. They're ready to drive our nation to succeed in the global economy and beyond. It starts with us to make sure it gets to them. So go to www.digitallearningday.org. Take the pledge to make a difference with digital learning. Find out more about how we can work together to make every day Digital Learning Day. Thank you very much.